I welcome all the participants for the fifth day and the last day program of this FDP on waste technologies, wealth from waste actually. Technology innovation, wealth from waste. Thank you all for showing your interest and then participating and learning from the experts actually. So now actually today, the last technical session we have by our professor, chief scientist, Dr. G. Shekaran, Ganesh Shekaran. Actually, he's there in CSIR, leather, Central Leather Research Institute, and then now he's on deputation on SRM University. And his area of interest is environmental technology, actually. This is maybe hot for our course, actually. And he's done MSc and PhD in environmental engineering. And sir, area of interest is environmental science and technology, immobilized cell-packaged bed reactor technology. Actually, after working in few time in industry, as well as in working in as a lecturer in college, engineering college, sir joined this department as Central Leather Research Institute actually, and he has got more than 35 years experience for his credit actually, and he has joined this institute in 1979 as a junior scientist and then assistant, and then he has rise to this chief scientist actually. Actually, sir has worked in the department actually on various aspects of liquid waste generated treatment like tanneries, textile, pharmaceutical, and chemical industries, sago industries, and from residential sewage aspect. Okay, so those are a lot of vast experiences there, and he's heading this department since many years, and he has carried out even consultancy work and analysis and water and wastewater, groundwater sampling analysis actually. And he has also developed a lot of technologies and water and wastewater, solid waste and gaseous management, and providing engineering design for treatment of waste in isolated and a cluster of industries, and conducting workshops and training to industries on environmental related issues. So like that, there are a lot of, to name a few. Sir is a member, professional member in Association of Waste Management and Remediation of Environment actually, that is AWARE. Sir has got a 36 international research publications, and he has developed like a chemoautotropic activated carbon oxidation system, and then Fenton activated carbon catalytic oxidation system, copper chemoautotropic activated carbon oxidation, and oxy functionalization of volatile organic carbon, destruction of volatile organic carbon using the oxy functionalization. And sir has visited many countries actually, Hong Kong, Spain, France, Germany, USA, Ethiopia, and maybe for this dissemination of his knowledge or sharing the knowledge in international forum. So I welcome you, sir. I'm really happy to introduce you and then invite you for our college for this online virtual program actually. So it is over to you, sir. I'm really indebted, sir, for your presence.
Okay. Good morning, Kola.
Sir, good morning.
Sir, yes. Participants may not, because we unmute them, they may not, maybe anything is there, they will unmute and us. Unmute and speak. You can just go on explaining, sir.
Sure, sir. Oh, sir. Thank you. So, good morning to participants. I'm glad to give you the lecture on the leather industry. That's an overview of leather industry for a few minutes. And then solid waste generated from the industry. and possible conversion into value added products. I am going to give you some four or five value added products. All have been reported from my students' thesis, and all are patented technologies. And some of them have been commercialized, and some of them yet to be commercialized. And of course, you can, some of the people or some of the participants can also do some research work on this. For this, if possible, you can contact me over phone number. I have given your mobile number, and I have given my email ID also. If you are possibly, you can have some cooperation or coordination with me for carrying out further more research on this field. It's a valuable field, and of course, it is nothing but to help this leather industry. And the solid waste generation from the industry is nearly about 60 to 70%, and the realizable product is only 30%. To that extent, how best we can able to convert the solid waste and the generated solid waste, how best we can able to market, and if you develop some strategy, it will be helping the industry as a nation, as well as international, the industries all over, spread over the world. To that extent, a few remarks on this. I just go ahead with this further slides. So more than 10,000 tanneries are spread across the globe, with the annual processing capacity of 9 million tons of hides and skins. Hides means these the flayed material coming from cow and buffalo. Skins are generated from sheep and goats. India has about 3,000 tanneries with a total processing capacity of 700,000 tons of hides and skins per year. And we have major clusters of tanneries in India, located in Tamil Nadu, contributing about 52% of annual production by this state. And West Bengal contributes about 36% of the total need. And Uttar Pradesh gives about 12%. And Punjab, we get about 5%. Of course, other small residual tanneries are clustered, that is scattered over other states also. So when you take up this leather industry, and the raw material wise, they got this hides, skins, sheep, goat, the skins obtained from this sheep and goat. Of course, to convert this raw hides or raw skins into final product, they need chemicals, varieties of chemicals. And actually, we say that more than about 105 chemicals are be involved in converting this raw material into finished material. Of course, we know that water is also an essential commodity. Or otherwise, we can say that a tanner is a water intensive industry. And of course, fresh air is required for this, the ambient to be maintained. And it's another one more thing, there's a major remark about this industry is, it's a labor oriented industry, because we are using only manual labors. And using that, this conversion is happening. And the products wise, they say that they have got wet blue tool leather, and crushed leather, and finished leather. During the conversion of the raw material into the finished products, they generate huge of effluent. To convert 1 kilogram of the raw hides into product, they need about 40 liters of water. Or per ton of material, they are generating about 40 meter cube of water is generated as an effluent. Of course, they also contribute to air pollution. And besides that, they are generating huge lot of solid waste. Some of them are processed and some of them are under disposal site. And this table shows that, and what are the chemicals broadly, if you say that they are using it. Anyway, I'll be covering some more fine chemicals also. And this is a chromium, that's a major hazardous, the material they use is chromium oxide. And they add in process of 25, that is the units, out of which 12 are said to be present in that, wastage is about 13 units. Organic tannins, they are using about 25 units, and out of which 20 is said to be present in this leather and 5 is wasted. Fat liquors, dye stuffs, acids, alkalis, then enzymes, finished products, all would be said to be some of them are said to be present in this leather, and most of them are said to be wasted. And you can say that acids, base and salts, out of which 191 units means 91 kilogram per ton of materials when they apply. And same 191 kilogram of the acids, base and salts are discharged. So that is, this is a concern for the TDS in the wastewater. And rest of things are organic TDS. And this contributes towards the inorganic TDS. So that's why I say that this industry is classified under having inorganic TDS as well as organic TDS. So that's a peculiarity of this industry. So just abroad, the tanning process consists of three distinct phases. One is the preparation of the hides. It is called a BMOS operation. And second stage is the actual tanning process takes place. It is called tanyard. That is nothing but importing the microbial resistant, thermal resistant leather for which they are impregnating this chromium. That is called the tanning. And final one is, in order to get a final finished product, this is called a post-tanning operation. So that BMOS operations, tanyard operation, and post-tanning operations. Now, it is giving this slide gives you that the important steps that takes place in the leather industry. The first step is a soaking, that is immersion of hides and skins in water to remove out the sodium chloride which has been applied earlier during slaughtering of animals. And this wastewater generated from this called a soak liquor. And of course, for the interest of the audience, I say that near about 9 to 10 years I spent on getting PhD degree on only this waste, that is soak liquor. Of course, still the problem is not solved. Internationally, the problem remains unsolved. Even though I spent a lot of time, and during my 30 years, 35 years of my research career also, here and then I was taking some work on the soak liquor, and still the problem is not solved. And another process is, next step is a liming process. This is nothing but to remove out the hair from present in the raw material, or otherwise for depilation of hair from this, the hides and skin, they apply lime and sodium sulfide. The wastewater generated from this section is called lime liquor. And another important area, that is waste coming out from this, is ammonia. And after this liming process, just mechanically they remove this air, and the solid waste generated in this section is called, that is hair. And after this, liming is not sufficient in the first, second process. They are going for re-liming and using this, the lime as a paste lime. And the wastewater generated contains a lot of lime, and so that is called a lime liquor. Again, it is generated. These two are said to be having lime. And after this process, it is the loose flush or separated out. So that flush is called animal flushing. That is a major solid waste generated from the waste, the industry. This is said to be bottleneck for the industry to be surviving. And of course, because we are applying this, the lime, some of the degraded material like ammonium will also be generated. And after this process, it's called a deliming, because whatever you added calcium into the process may be get absorbed onto this collagen fibers. In order to make it soft leather, they have to apply some deliming agent like ammonium chloride and ammonium sulfate. So the wastewater generated is known as delimed liquor. And because addition of ammonium chloride and the alkaline pH is available, so the ammonia is liberated heavily in this section. These two sections, liming and deliming, the ammonia generation is very, very little amount. Whereas in the case of third, that is the deliming section, the ammonia concentration generated is very high. Again, the work is very much required to go for this detoxification of ammonia in this area. And followed by this is called a pickling process. It's nothing but preparing the material to take up tanning material. So in this case, they are adding buffered sulfuric acid with sodium sulfuric acid. They add sodium chloride, and this sodium chloride containing wastewater is said to be pickled liquor. In addition to that, because in the earlier section, liming process, they were adding sodium sulfide. So in this section, because acid is added, so this and sodium sulfide, which has been added on this collagen fiber, will be emitted as hydrogen sulfide. So this ammonia is an important gaseous pollutant coming out, and hydrogen sulfide is another important pollutant is coming out from the industry. Again, work is required to go for this detoxification. And after following by this pickling process, it goes for this tanning operation. As already mentioned, that tanning is one is to import this the microbial resistance, thermal resistance, and environmental resistance to this the finished leather, for which they add this two type of tanning agents. One we can call it as a mineral tanning. The mineral tanning will be adding this basic chromium sulfate in the acidic medium they will add. And second one is they will go by this vegetable tanning. That is, the polyphenolic compounds will also be added in order to get the same type of, or otherwise same quality of leather. So that is a tanning operation. And here this discharge waste liquor is called a tan liquor, containing maximum concentration of chromium and polyphenolic compounds. So that is depends on the type of leather, whether we can get the basic chromium sulfate as the waste liquor, or otherwise polyphenolic compounds will be the basic car. And followed by this, they go by this shaving, and this solid base generated at this section is called chrome shavings. This is also a point where in which we need to have some technology to separate out the chromium blended onto this the loose material and also use the material for some other purpose. So it's a point of research on this line is required. And followed by this chroming shaving, now we have go for this retanning. Whatever the chromium applied onto the leather, it should be permanently fixed onto the leather matrix, for which they are going by this retanning. That is, some synthetic organic chemicals or synthetic polyphenolic compounds will be added at this section in order to pluck this chromium, not to come out or not to leach out during the process. Or otherwise, when the finished leather is exposed to this conventional aerobic, that is environmental condition, it should not be stripped out. For that reason, the polyphenolic compounds will be added in this section. That's called the wastewater coming out from the section is called the retanning wastewater, which has got a very less VOD and very high COD. That is the major characteristics of this wastewater coming out. And so that the biodegradability of the wastewater at this section, retanning wastewater section, typically very, very low, and lot more research is required on this direction or to solve this issue. And of course, followed by this, so far this way the material was in acidic side. Now they are going for the neutralization using sodium bicarbonate, and the wastewater comes out is called a neutralized wastewater. Of course, it's harmless. And followed by this, wet finishing operations start, and then trimming, that is cutting, buffing, and finishing operations. And for that, this material is ready for the that is, in the finishing operation, they can add some solvents, that is hexane, acetone, many amount of the solvents are added. For it is nothing but in order to give this top coat or a desirable finish or ambient color is to be given. For that, the finishing section is used. Now, this slide shows that the mass balance. When you convert 1 metric ton of wet salted hides and skins, wet salted means because as soon as this animal skins are flayed from this animal, it is in order to avoid this microbial putrefaction during the transport and storage, they add sodium chloride. And in the wet condition only, this hides and skins are received in the tannery. That's why it's called wet salted hides and skins. And out of this 1 metric ton, they get only 250 kilogram to 300 kilogram is the realizable leather. Or otherwise, the finished leather will be about 250 to 300 kilogram. Or otherwise, 700 to 750 kilogram of the leather matrix is effectively wasted material. Or otherwise, that's a base, solid base. About 250 kilogram of tanned solid waste is coming out. That is, as chromium tanned solid waste is about 250 kilogram, and 350 kilogram of non-tanned solid waste. That is, whatever the solid waste generated before coming to the tan yard is called a non-tanned solid waste. That is, nearly about 350 kilogram. And out of this, that is raw material, 100 kilogram of raw material is simply lost into the wastewater. So this nothing but this 100 kilogram contributes towards the protein and other natural material present in the wastewater, contributing towards our VOD and COD. The solid waste generated in this leather industry are distributed as animal flushing or non-tanned solid waste, contributing or otherwise given as 56 to 60%. And chrome shaving, that is chromium containing the shaved material, or chrome splits, which may not be useful product, will be, and buffing dust, that is a microfine dust particle which is coming out, contributing into the, all the three, 35 to 40%. And the skin trimming, that is normally we can say non-tanned trimming before it comes to the further operation, it contributes about 5 to 7%, hair 2.5%. So out of which we can say chrome shaving, chrome splits, buffing dust are carrying chromium, that is azotous materials are present, whereas animal flushing, skin trimming and hair are said to be only proteinous and collagenous material, and of course it requires some edible purpose. And across the globe, nearly about 1,643 tons of the material or solid waste is generated, out of which say 50% is coming from India alone. Nearly about 800 tons of the solid waste is generated across this country. So that's what I said, that the BMOS process is made more detailed in that. The BMOS process, incoming hides or skins is soaked in water for 16 to 24 hours to remove blood, dirt, salt and to rehydrate the dried hides. and the hydrates are immersed in next stage. The hydrates are immersed in lime and sodium sulfate solution for 12 to 18 hours to loosen this the collagen fibers and to remove the hair from this the raw material. It is being carried out in pit or otherwise carried out in drum. After liming, the hydrates are scrapped mechanically. That's why the first the picture shows that how the man is doing that on mechanically to remove all this excess flesh. So this flesh is called animal flushing, which has that is being thrown out in the industry. That is a second picture shows that this flushing can generated out of it. Earlier days they were using it for making the glue out of it, and nowadays after synthetic glue has come into the market, so the takers for making this glue from this animal flushing is very much reduced, and the industry is very much fixed on how to throw this animal flushing as a solid waste, and they cannot throw it on this open yard, and then lot of limitations are there, and of course no converted products yet to come from that in the commercial level, so that again they are said to be not to able to manage this issue. And if you look into this, the characteristics of animal flushing very interestingly shows that total organic carbon is about 340 milligram per gram, and 34% of the solid waste is only organic carbon. Total nitrogen, the total Zeldon nitrogen is about 130 milligram per gram. And of course, this moisture content of the material is about 30%. Ash content of the material is 21%, contributed by the that is calcium, sodium, and other components. And total protein, as approximate analysis due to that, total protein of the animal flushing is 67% measure of the protein. And fat is about 4.3%, carbohydrate very little. And collagen as a bundle, we can say that 3.5% is present in this. That is, the low molecular protein is maximum, and high molecular weight protein like collagen is only 3.5%. So that this cannot be used as a resource material for trapping of this collagen from this. And it can be considered as the protein recovery, because the protein content or loose protein like albumin and globulin are said to be more in this particular animal flushing. So that research has to be motivated only in that direction. And the nitrogen content as a percentage wise, we say that 14.6% conveniently available, and carbon is about 39% and sulfur is about 0.4%. And having seen that this animal flushing has got this carbon and nitrogen as a major resources, and also as a component wise, they have got a more of protein, and people tried this many of the technologies and anaerobic digestion, and further they went for this thermal incineration and just put it on the soil as an agricultural blender. And of course, when the takers are not available, just to dump it on the coal, that is land, as a coal disposal. And thermal incineration method is not that much releasable, because it emits nitrogen oxide, sulfur oxides, carbon dioxide in the unavoidable nature, and so that it can, that is, pollutes the atmosphere. And the nitrogen content of the material, high nitrogen content of the leather, is mainly due to the forms condensed amino acid, and also generate this hydrocyanic acid and ammonia during the thermal incineration. That is the main issue of this, and so that this material cannot be considered for thermal incineration as such. But in certain pockets of our country, still the people are doing this thermal incineration in order to avoid the dumping of this material. When that dumping is permanently discouraged, so naturally the people have to go in, that is unlawful practice of the burning this leather matrix. So once you burn the leather matrix, and that's what I indicated, that it emits this ammonia and hydrocyanic acid, and also you can say that it emits nitrogen oxide, sulfur oxide, that is carbon monoxide. So this is nothing but causing the material more environmental pollutant. And that's what I say, that when the people are not able to get the proper technology, opted method is just to dump it on this open soil. And that's what land core disposal method, we say that unavoidably we can emit this carbon dioxide, methane, due to this putrefaction of the material. And during this course of this undergoing anaerobic digestion, when the matrix is completely broken down and some of the metal ions which are said to be absorbed or otherwise impregnated with this, the matrix is said to be leached out in the groundwater, causing groundwater pollution. And another one more thing, since this land availability also very much reduced, so the people are not able to go for the land port disposal, the unavailability of land and stringent national waste disposal standard and public consciousness have made the people not to dump this solid material onto the landfill. Still, even though these three, the stringents are present, and the people find a way for disposing this, the solid waste, since the material is not being taken away with the utilizable value, and no technology is available, so they are forced to take up this. And this point of time, I want to say that that industry need not be penalized, or industry need not be that is threatened for this. But actually, the industry is doing its job of converting the raw material into the finished leather. But only thing is, the environmentalists who are participants of this conference also humbly request that you can focus some idea on this. You can develop some technologies so that the people or the industry will be very much benefited. So that my opinion that environmental consultants or environmental technologists like us and should be responsible for having this problem exposed to this land post disposal or danger to the environment. And of course, this is the technology developed by me. This is a vermicomposting of fermented animal flushing. And of course, this has come from bottlenecks also. Because in the vermicomposting, you know that earthworms can be used for solid waste management, organic matter stabilization, soil detoxification, and vermicompost production. And generated product is very stable and homogeneous, having desirable aesthetics, like reduced levels of contaminants. The process is process is faster than composting because the material passes through the earthworm gut, whereby resulting earthworm casting are richer in microbial activity and plant growth regulator. So for this reason, I have tried this. I have just produced one thesis out of which the technology is also available. And this material, the vermicomposted material, are very good plant growth promoter and regulators also there. And of course, we got good result, and still it was not able to be practiced in this field due to certain disadvantages. Vermicomposting is a mesophilic process utilizing microorganisms and the earthworms at 10 to 32 degrees centigrade. And although we can say that the microorganisms are responsible for degrading the solid material, and of course, we can say that earthworm is said to be the driver or a carrier of this microorganism. Many type of bacteria we could able to isolate from this earthworm gut, and fungi also said to be present in the vermicomposted soil, and proteolytic bacteria was very much present in this vermicomposted soil. It's a very good, that is an evidence for having some good bacteria out of this gut material, and very good fungi material also present in the vermicomposted soil, and very good for growth promotion of this plants. The inoculated earthworms maintained aerobic condition. That is a one advantage. That is advantage or disadvantage. I can put into the matter that it requires this aeration. It is also an aerobic organism, macroorganism, as considered by macrophyte. And one important thing regarding this is a very very sensitive animal. It is not like, as you say, that earthworm is said to be a dirty animal. It is very very sophisticated animal, and it requires this very good ambient environment. Then only it can able to survive that. It cannot take up all the solid waste for mineralization. It requires a specific condition to be maintained. And this is a portion of organic materials are converted first into the anaerobic condition and mineralized or otherwise break down these molecules. And finally, it is converted to aerobically. That is the reason some of the heavy metal ions present in this feed material also will be converted into the non-toxic or other non-leachable oxides. To that extent, the earthworms will be benefiting us. That is the mineralizable solid, or otherwise the minerals or ionic material which are present in your initial feed material will be converted to oxide. To conversion of the minerals into the non-leachable oxides, now earthworm can also be considered as a potential driver. And during vermicomposting, earthworms eat, grind, digest organic waste with the help of aerobic and sometimes anaerobic microflora, converting them into much finer and humified and microbially active material. That is very good. That is because once you degrade the material into the fine material, and further it can be applied onto the soil, so that assimilability by the plant will be very much good. Because not only this divide this original food into smaller food, at the same time it generates lot of enzymes or lot of cofactors also generated by the vermicomposting, so that it is amenable or otherwise assimilable by the plant material. And what are the demerits of this method? That's what I found that. Normally, vermicomposting process requires 60 to 90 days. Even in my thesis, I could able to find out that 28 to 30 days. Still, I consider that is a vast retention period and not possible to employ this technology for all this. That is the reason even solid waste or municipal solid waste management also does not go with this vermicomposting. And another one more thing, I said that this is a sophisticated animals and requires the environment devoid of the toxic material. So in that case, any toxic constituents are present in this feed material, it cannot survive. That is also another bottleneck. Another one important thing is the ammonia. And once the ammonia concentration in the feed material increases to a greater level, now that is the organism cannot survive or it cannot present in that. So that it requires some pre-treatment before it is applied to this, the vermicompost. And that's what I consider that this is a bottleneck for this particular technology, could not promote for the demineralization, that is the mineralization of animal flushing into the field level. And second one, I consider that animal flushing for biogas recovery. This is very good technology. Already we implemented this technology in the field level also. And this is nothing but biomethanization, that is biomethanization or anaerobic digestion of the tannery waste material into the gases, that is a biogas. And from the biogas, we can able to go for this energy production. And this route is anaerobic digestion, converting the solid waste material to liquefied material. And from the liquefied material, we can able to generate methane gas. From the methane gas, we can go for this energy, that is electricity generation be possible. And this table or otherwise, this figure is very much familiar to you. When you take up this macromolecule compound, that is insoluble complex organic materials like lipid, protein, and carbohydrate, the fermented bacteria can convert it into intermediate products like fatty acids, amino acids, and sugar. And with the help of acidogenic bacteria, this intermediate product can be converted into acetate. And of course, during the production of acetate or acetic acid, we can generate this hydrogen and carbon dioxide. So methanogenic bacteria is available to convert hydrogen and carbon dioxide into methane, so that methane can be developed out of this hydrogen and carbon dioxide. And decarboxylation of acetate done by this methanogenic bacteria, we can get methane and carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide will nearly about 24% to 26% will be the emission of carbon dioxide from this, the anaerobic process. Or otherwise, your biogas will consist of methane, carbon dioxide, and since you are dealing with the nitrogen, so that ammonia will be liberated. Since you are dealing with sulfur containing amino acid, so that hydrogen sulfide will also be a part of it. So that we have to manage the biogas comprising of methane, carbon dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, and ammonia when you go for this first further use of it. So 10% of the gap between carbon, that is COD, inlet COD and outlet COD, that is considered to be the retained within the bioreactor as a biomass. Or otherwise, the biomass production is said to be very, very less in your anaerobic process. As for the liquid waste is concerned, whereas in the case of solid waste management is concerned, because your efficiency is somewhere between 50 to 60% only, and remaining 30 to 40% of solid waste cannot be digested. So that anaerobic digestion cannot be given as a foolproof method for complete decomposition of the solid waste, or in fact, we can say the animal flushing present in the solid, that is the industry. Based on the practical experience, we could able to get that the generation of biogas will be in the order of 0.3 to 0.32 meter cube of methane per kilogram of COD degraded. And the that is a function is given that ratio. That is the methane recovery will be 0.5 minus 4 minus 1.5 COD to TOS. It's more depend on COD to TOS ratio, that is said to be the mineralizable organic material. COD to TOS ratio is a very important thing to designate whether the material in the polymeric stage or in the oligopolymeric stage or in the monomeric stage. That can be obtained from the ratio of COD to TOS ratio. The COD to TOS ratio is important as far as the environmental application is concerned, for liquid waste management as well as the solid waste management. So biogas produced in anaerobic digester consists of methane will be in the range of 50% to 80% only, and carbon dioxide in the range of 20% to 50%, and rest of things will be managed by hydrogen, carbon monoxide, nitrogen and hydrogen sulfide, and some cases unutilized oxygen will also be generated, and lot more theories to be put forward on to increase in the efficiency of the system. I myself have got this lot of the feed questions, how to enhance this anaerobic digestion process more effectively, and what are the bottlenecks present, and what are the intermediates present which are considered to be toxic to the organism, more of the things to be answered. And biogas can be used for producing electricity and heat, and as a natural gas substitute as the transportation of fuel. And this particular application shows that we have used this animal flushing in order to generate this biogas commercially, and we could able to generate 0.415 meter cube of methane per kilogram of it. That's why in the laboratory level it is 0.3 to 0.2, whereas when the went to the field, it was only 0.15 meter cube per kilogram of material. And the indicative energy of biogas is about 1.7 kilowatt hour electricity per meter cube of material. The combined production of electricity and heat is highly desirable because it displaces non-renewable energy. For this case, the MNAS is for giving this fund for getting this energy, electrical energy from this solid waste. So fund could be able to obtain from this other funding sources also. Sir, any other disturbance, sir? Any?
There's no disturbance, sir. Very, very clear.
Okay. Okay. Sir, you can moderate. Suppose if I'm going or extending something, you can just moderate.
No problem, sir.
And when you say that this slide shows us a scheme, how this being worked out in the field, it's very, very interesting for some of the people who can take up the work. It can also be possible because I just tell you that where I ended and what are things further required. So this is a very interesting slide. The tannery solid waste, it goes to the fermentation using bacteria, that is microbes. And further it is being chemical or biocatalytic treatment is required, enzymatic treatment. And now this is a stage, if you stop at this fermentation using microbes and further you can go for biomethanization, that's a conventional route. Now you can break the route by intervening chemical and biocatalytic treatment and trying to get as a biodiesel. And now this intermediate fatty acids are produced. The intermediate fatty acids can be converted into biodiesel possibly. And further this, it can be converted to bioethanol and biohydrogen, biomethane. This is before getting the biomethane, another possibility of getting three more products. That is, you can get in terms of biodiesel and you can get in terms of bioethanol and you can get into biohydrogen possibly. And another one more route I tried, that biodiesel by decarboxylation process. Further, I went to biopetrol. This is, I tried, I could not be successful in this. This is also very, very promising route. The people can try on this. And of course, bioethanol production from this is also very, very complicated steps, because here this is nothing but the ammonia will be the bottleneck. And now if we eliminate that, probably we can able to end with this bioethanol. And biohydrogen is produced, but is very, very little quantity, that 4% alone will be coming out. And once you take up the hydrogen, that is biomethane, it will be affected. So that is synchronizing is taking place. Our integration takes place between the biohydrogen and the carbon dioxide. So if you break the chain, and again, methane formation is very much reduced. So these are the area I touched, and I could not able to come to this final conclusion. So these are the good area where you can intervene. And another one more thing, what are the biocatalytics? You are innovative. Your innovation is very much involved in this, the chemical and biocatalytic route. And further, if you say that biodiesel, that's what I said, if you open your patent search, more than about 2 lakh patents are available on getting the biodiesel. But most of the patents are not viable or no workable. So that's why that instead of go is the biodiesel. And if you propose to go for the biopetrol, this is very, very viable technology, because I started and then I could not able to complete the work, or rather still I'm struggling for this route. This we can able to try that. And another one interesting thing is this, we could able to complete, you could able to patent on this. This is acid protease from proteinase animal solid waste. Most of the people went on alkaline protease, and I was the one who started with this acid protease. This is the another biomolecule which showed a very promising result on the pharmaceutical product also. The animal fleshing has been considered as a substrate, as a carbon and energy substrate for the production of protease and lipase as a valuable product. So this is my key chain. And proteases find application in detergents, leather industry, food industry, pharmaceutical industry, and laundry industry. Whereas detergents, leather industry, food industry, they were doing it, laundry industry, they were doing it, alkaline protease. One day pharmaceutical industry was looking for acid protease. So that is the reason I went into the direction. And also the protease can also be used in the bioremediation process and wound healing process. Again, it depends on acid protease, not on alkaline protease. So proteases have been used in the dehydrating process in the leather industry itself. They are using it as alkaline protease. That's what I give that. Acid protease has been proved to catalyze the breakdown of wide range of substrate. That's why this material can be used in edible or otherwise in the pharmaceutical grade. If you make that, it is a very good impact. In view of the innumerable properties of protease, the acid protease was immobilized in nanoporous structure. This is my technology. Because normally, whenever I use the technology or whenever I get the biomolecule, I will not use it as a free material. Or when you use it as a free substrate, it is a loss of material will be available. So in order to avoid the loss of the material, immobilization technology is very important. For the immobilization of the matrix or immobilization of this enzyme or a biomolecule, I invented a matrix that is a nanoporous activated carbon matrix. And this nanoporous activated carbon matrix invented by me. I really worked for more than 16 years to get the material. And this material, now we are making it commercially and we are exporting the material to other countries also. Based on this material. Hello? Hello? Dr. Puttasamy?
Sir, you can go ahead, sir. You can go ahead, sorry.
Okay. So now this is the material which I have prepared that are invented material. I am giving the characteristics like carbon 48%. Percentage carbon present in the material is about 48%. It's innovative process. And nowhere in the world that material is being produced. That is, we are the proprietary item of the material as of us. Hydrogen containing points.
Monday it will be done, sir. Coming Monday.
Ash content of the material in the range of 40%. Apparent density of the material is 0.4. And decolorizing power of the material is very, very less. It is about 22 milligram per gram. So this material on the whole, I want to impress that the material of this, even though it's a carbon material, it cannot be considered as an adsorbent. It is nothing but a catalyst. The first time we propose the material, carbon-based material can be put into the market as catalyst. Then only we can say that the realization of graphene came in. And I was the person who started this work as carbon-containing material as a catalyst in the way back in 1980 to 1990 itself. And application of immobilized acid protease for the production of protein hydrolase. It's very, very important, the material used in the pharmaceutical industry. The protein hydrolysates are classified into three major groups depending on the degree of hydrolysis. Hydrolysates with low degree hydrolysis. That is, we can say that the raw material protein, if you hydrolyze with a low degree, that hydrolysis is called low degree of hydrolysis. Hydrolysis with a variable degree of hydrolysis called medial level, and it can be used in flavorings. Most of the flavoring materials it can be used. Hydrolysis with extensive hydrolysis that are mostly used in nutritional supplements and dietary. And this is nothing but oligopeptides can be obtained out of this acid protease. It is nothing but geriatric products or dietary geriatric material can be obtained out of these hydrolysates. The protein hydrolysate can be used as a continual constituent of medical diets. The gastrointestinal absorption of hydrolysis can be more effective than the other material. So for a geriatrics or infants whose assimilability level is very less, in that case, we can be able to give this oligopeptides by cleaving with the protein hydrolysates. So that protein hydrolysates are very much absorbed by this, the gut of this infants and geriatrics. And another important biomolecule I developed is the proteolysin. It is nothing but is obtained from the animal fleshing as a source material. It is nothing but used for antimicrobial properties. This is also very good. It's a competent factor in colonization of swimming, swarming and air dispersion area and protection against antimicrobial agents, and it can be used as a metabolic sink. And the theoretical consideration behind this, it's a bacterial secondary metabolite. Proteolysin is a secondary metabolite of the animal flushing as a substrate. So that here what you can that animal flushing is the primary metabolite. The primary metabolite, when it enters into the area, it produces a secondary metabolite. The secondary metabolite is considered as the antimicrobial agent. This could be considered as a very good commercial output out of the animal flushing. So this is the, you can see that when the animal flushing is put onto this fermentation by anaerobic bacteria, and this produces a secondary metabolite, and during which case the pigmented product will be obtained by this microorganism. So using the microorganism, we can able to synthesize this, the pigmented product proteolysin, and this material has got very good antimicrobial property. selection of pathogens. This will be done only by pathogens. That is only one limitation. The bacterial activity of the protection paper was tested against a pathogenic strain, Escherichia coli, gram-negative bacteria, against a Bacillus subtilis, gram-positive bacteria, all were tested. And those shows that very good complete elimination of the pathogenic bacteria from the liquid stream or even for food material also. This pathogen, there is this colorant or otherwise natural pigment can be used for controlling this pathogenic bacteria in edible protein or edible food also, we can able to do that. And for which what we did is, that is the protection was impregnated in paper and the fecal containing bacteria was allowed to expose to this impregnated paper and found that this bacteria is completely inactivated or completely dead by testing with this agar fly. And this was shows that when the concentration of the protection on the level of 10 milligram per gram of cellulose paper, this could be just used as a strip to deactivate the bacteria from the water containing the fecal material or pathogenic bacteria. This was successfully produced and then demonstrated also. And this shows that after this the bacteria have inactivated or otherwise assumed to be dead and exposed to the nutrient media, we found that there was no further growth takes place, and even though it was exposed for more than 4 days. And another third important application what I made on this solid waste material, conversion of chromium containing solid waste. So far I mentioned that non-tanned solid waste, that is animal flushing, I was considering that the potential solid waste available with the industry to be converted to certain biomolecules. Another one more biomolecule I purposely stopped here, and that biomolecule also very much commercially available, and it can be patented that material has got a very good application towards sequestering these heavy metals from the soil. And another one more thing, this biomolecule has got a very good application in the treatment of municipal leachate also. That molecule I have not showed here. And another one more thing, that is said to be non-tanned solid waste, even though this material was thrown out, unused, and so that material can be taken out for getting further more biomolecules. Because in my career, I could able to find out enzyme can be developed, rhodiocosin to be developed, another one named biomolecule also to be developed out of it. But you can also probe more into that, how to convert that material into value-added material. And once you find out the value addition to this material, the industry, leather industry, will be taking only that material as the raw material for them to go for the manufacturing side. So this leather production will become a secondary, and then conversion of the solid waste will be the primary for the industry. So that's why the paradigm shift should come. So that is, instead of considering this raw material, raw hides and skins converted to leather, and we should say that raw hides and skins is converted to value-added material meant for this many type of trades. More are available with them. And now when I come to this chromium containing solid waste, and I consider that the chromium containing solid waste already mentioned that chrome shaving, buffing dust and chrome splits, and those are considered the chrome containing solid waste. And nearly about 90% of global leather production is carried out throughout this by the chrome tanning process alone. Only 10% of global leather production by vegetable tanning, and remaining 90% will go by this chrome tanning. And some of the people are doing aluminum tanning and titanium tanning also. It's a very, very negligible quantity. But major, it is nothing but chrome tanning using basic chromium sulfate as the tanning agent, or otherwise chrome containing tan. That is also another one more area we have to touch that. That basic chromium will be obtained only from divalent chromium, or sorry, hexavalent chromium. That is, they take the dichromate as the primary soup. From the dichromate, they convert it to trivalent chromium. And trivalent chromium, that is chromium sulfate, they basify it called basic chromium sulfate. So that the route must be clear to you. That is, a dichromate will be converted to basic chromium, that is a chromium sulfate will be basified with this basic agent and converted to the basic chromium sulfate. So the basic chromium sulfate is the tanning agent in the leather industry. Out of this total leather production, 90% will go by this chrome tanning, and chrome tanned solid waste. That's why I say that chromium containing solid waste. Now we say that without chromium and solid waste, what we discussed earlier, now it is nothing but with chromium, what are the solid waste coming out? That forms nearly about 45% to 50% of the raw material. So nearly about 50% of the raw material will be coming out as a chrome tanned solid waste. Nearly about 1 ton of material, when it is processed, they get about 250 to 350 gram of leather. And Dwayne says that 4450 to 550 gram of material per kg of material will be assessed chromic containing material. About 1500 tons of chrome tan leather solid waste is discharged per day. The basic chromium sulfate is widely used as a tanning material, already told. About 90 tons of basic chromium sulfate is used per day in India, and about 54 tons of chromium is fixed in the leather matrix. And the solid waste contains about 16 gram of chromium per kilogram of solid waste. So you can find out that 16% of chromium will be thrown out in the solid waste. And this is considered to have this, the thought process for converting this, the chromium containing solid waste into a useful material. And out of which, one simple material is called a buffing dust. It's contributed only 2%, but its impact is very, very high. Because the buffing dust is a microfined solid matrix, microfined leather solid matrix, it is said to be carcinogenic in matrix. Because as well as the another waste is called the chrome shaving, which is not carrying any sort of the carcinogenic material. Because this buffing dust is produced after completion of this finished process. Between chrome tanning and post tanning, there is a gap. That is nothing but during this post tanning, they are adding a lot of chemicals. That chemical will be fixed up on the finished leather, and before it to get to this ambient leather, they are made, that is buffing this material. So that dust coming out of it is called a buffing dust. It's a microfine particulate. It is said to be in the range of suspended particulate matter level. And this buffing dust carries not only this material like protein, leather, that is carcinogenic material, and chromium also said to be present in it. That's why it gives the weightage on this. The buffing dust may be regarded as heavy metal ions, that is chromium ion, is embedded in collagen matrix. So now we have to view that buffing dust is a heavy metal impregnated collagen matrix. So the dispersal of buffing dust in an environmentally sound manner is an important task. And of course, people are trying, have been trying, and they are now trying also, but no viable solution has been arrived at so far. So what is the problem definition of this? The chrome tanned leather solid waste is non-biodegradable and toxic due to the presence of chromium. That's what we cannot end up with a biotechnological process of managing this solid waste. The presence of chromium in leather solid waste represents a potential hazard to the possibility of converting chromium 3 plus into chromium 6 plus. That is very important. When you throw that, that chromium containing leather waste into the environment, you say that a finished product, your shoe, that is used to shoe, when you throw it on this soil or in the open atmosphere, there are likelihood of converting the chromium 3 plus into chromium 6 plus. Chromium 3 plus is non-toxic, and once it is converted into chromium 6 plus, it is toxic. Or thermodynamically, it is possible to come from chromium 3 plus to 3 plus 6 plus. It's so viable. And this material is said to be considered as a toxic or hazardous material as for this, the environmentalist are concerned. The disposal of solid waste has been a bottleneck in the industry. Because once I say that, why I say that bottleneck? As far as you are taking out the solid waste from the industry, the production of the leather matrix will be continued. Or otherwise, when the solid waste is disposed or otherwise heaped in the industry, then again, NGO that is threatening or otherwise pollution control board discomfort made to the industry not to run the industry. So that's why they have to clear that solid waste as and when it's produced. That's why it's a bottleneck or limiting factor to the industry. The collagen fibers, the dominant key component in the solid waste generated in the leather industry, may improve the impact resistance of asphalt ceramic composite. This is what I could be able to realize, that instead of throwing out the material or contributing to this complicated nature, why not you mix with this the ceramic material, or otherwise we can able to mix with this asphalt material. Once you mix up with the asphalt material, it can go for the road making industry. Or if you make up this a ceramic material, or otherwise it's clay or Portland cement, so this metal can be used in the construction industry. That's what I viewed, that there are two types of applications. So when you consider road making industry has been exploiting ceramic material in a considerable quantity. You know that they are using gravel and then other the blue metal materials and sand also they are using it. And so that this is considered to have this natural resources. And once you mix up this material with asphalt, and so that we can able to get, that is actually they are mixing the ceramic material in order to get the micro layer to reduce wear and tear of the vehicular component. That is the purpose they are going with. They are adding asphalt and other ceramic material in order to reduce the wear and tear of the vehicular component. and thermal conductivity of the asphalt and other ceramic material is very high and low abrasion resistance, so that the loss of material due to evaporation and abrasion takes place. That is the major issue of the present asphalt and ceramic material combination. So now, in order to avoid the loss of material due to evaporation and abrasion, suppose if we replace the ceramic composite of the material or ceramic component of conventional the matrix by our matrix, and this problem is solved. This is what our research went on. So we could able to find out the thermal conductivity of the material very much reduced, and so that the loss of the material due to evaporation and abrasion was considerably reduced on that way. Hence, the life of the material can be shortened and the frequent relaying of the microbial is warranted. This is the present level of the problem associated with them. The above shortcomings of the present composite may be avoided by using the fibrous material. Because once I use this fibrous material obtained out of this the solid waste, and it can able to increase the resistance or increase the wear and resistance of the material, and thereby we can able to use it for long life of the material. The collagen fibers, the dominant key component of the solid waste generated in the leather industry, may improve the impact resistance of the asphalt and ceramic composite. That's what I can say that. Now, instead of considering asphalt and ceramic as a material, and suppose you use the collagen fibers also interleaved in this, so this is nothing but giving a composite material. So this composite material has this very high the resistance towards this wear and tear. So this material was identified and went on in the direction to produce this. Conversion of the proteinous solid base into non-hazardous chromium-containing solid matrix. So this was converted. The chromium-containing solid matrix, asphalt and ceramic composite composition was developed to withstand their own environmental applications for road making industry. And evaluation of mechanical properties of the material has been done. And evaluation of leachable characteristics, because when the people avoid the limitation, the chromium is present in the solid matrix, that is our leather matrix. Whether the chromium will be leached out during the environmental application. This also we proved that because the chromium was said to be in the comfortable position, and so that this chromium was not completely leached out when it was present or otherwise blended with this asphalt, so that non-leachable form was produced. This conversion of solid waste generated from the leather industry under controlled oxygen environment, we could do that. That is the pyrolysis. That's what Dr. Puttusamy, that we can able to go with that, because you said magnetic pyrolysis is available. So the magnetic pyrolysis can be used in this section as a replacement of pyrolysis. This can be worked out so that a comfortable or economically viable technology to develop on this. That is again, because the pyrolysis of this existing pyrolysis unit is very, very costly. Because of that, we could not able to introduce this into the market. So pyrolysis to produce chromium embedded nanocarbon matrix. This can be obtained as a byproduct when this material is that is burnt in the pyrolysis unit. So while you are pyrolyzing this solid matrix, you will get a fuel gas or fuel oil. Along with that, the ash will be produced. This ash can be going to the asphalt material. That's what the idea behind it. The chromium embedded nanoporous carbon matrix is treated with nano iron to prevent the oxidation of trivalent chromium to hexavalent chromium. So there is a possibility of retaining this trivalent chromium as that is in the same state without converting into hexavalent chromium. The nano iron containing residual ash is solidified and stabilized with the low percentage of sand at Portland cement. This we able to demonstrate. Optimization of parameters to obtain lightweight construction material. Also, we could able to accomplish that the lightweight material production. Leachability of the solidified matrix was completely fixed. No leachability of carbon, that is chromium 3 plus, was evidenced. So when you consider this chromium laden waste, that is waste, the moisture content is 11 to 11%, ash content is 45%, bulk density is 0.16, fat content of the material is 0.4.69, and chromium 3 present in the material is 10.68 milligram per kilogram. And of course, chromium is nil. Gross calorific value of this leather solid material is said to be 4096 kilocalories per gram. It is containing very high caloric value. So carbon content of the material is 37%, hydrogen is 6%, nitrogen is 6%, and sulfur is 1% oxygen. So this material, that is chromium containing material, or otherwise you can say consider chromium laden solid waste, and this was considered as a raw material for getting the fuel gas or fuel oil. And this pyrolysis was the laboratory level pyrolysis unit we tried and fabricated, and then we got this. It is also a patented technology. And pyrolysis in a fixed bed reactor at a temperature of 450 to 800 degrees centigrade, we could able to produce fuel gas, fuel oil. Of course, the nitrogen containing material will be converted as ammonium carbonate. So valuable material we can get. That is a very novelty of the process. One is the fuel gas we'll get, another one more very good calorific value containing fuel oil will be contained, and ammonium carbonate, whatever the nitrogen present in this raw material, will be converted as ammonium carbonate, so valuable material. And carbonaceous residue, that is the unburnt carbon, will be present in your the residue or otherwise in the ash. So fuel gas will be about 150 gram equivalent of Indian gas will be produced. The fuel oil calorific value 7200 kilocalories per liter of fuel oil could be produced out of it. The carbonaceous reduce, or otherwise you can call it as a charge produced, by having this 37.5% to 48% as the carbon residue. Calorific value of the material still, it is 4300 to 6300 kilocalories. So this material can be briquetted and it can be charged to the furnaces. You can get calorific value, and after that the material can be disposed of very easily. So that route way is, first you go for pyrolysis and get a fuel gas and fuel oil. Nitrogen can be taken out as ammonium carbonate, and then carbonaceous reduce can be made into briquette and can be used for used as a fuel material for furnaces. And after that, when the ash is coming out, the ash can be solidified, or otherwise it can be sent to this asphalt industry or other road making industry. So it's very profitable one. You can say that the pyrolysis and whatever the fuel gas comes, that it is condensed, and while you're condensing it, we can get oil. And the again, the fuel gas can be, the flue gas will be scrubbed, and again get back this oil, put back into the inter unit, and this fuel gas can be used for burning up. And what is the char comes out with having a high calorific value, can go to these furnaces and take out the energy, suck the energy, and rest of the residual ash will be present. The residual ash can be consolidated, rather is solidified. So this was demonstrated to the other countries also, because we had these visitors and then I showed them. Then there was a positivity, or otherwise a promising of taking out the material at the field level. So that's why the advantage of the material is generation of fuel oil of high calorific value, generation of the ash into building material is possible, and generation of the inorganic fertilizer out of this. So whatever the nitrogen content of the material, nearly about 4% in the raw material, now that can be completely converted as ammonium carbonate. That is the possibility of getting all the three as a value added product. This is a very promising technology. And only thing is, I end up with this only the energy. What is the energy input in this? That is, the pyrolysis requires the temperature of 450 to 800 degrees centigrade. To that amount, we have to supply energy. Any other lows or energy conserving reactors are available, incinerator available, the technology will be highly viable. Solidification and stabilization, because the ash result comes out, has to be solidified. First, it has to be converted as solid matrix. And another one more thing, the chromium present and has to be stabilized. That's a process called solidification and stabilization. And another possibility is, now this ash can be blended with the asphalt. Asphalt is the binder and can be used for making this road pavement material. About 90 to 95% weight of asphalt consists of hydrogen, carbon and nitro atoms. And this asphalt can be, that is, burned with the ash present in it. So this what, after this, the ash was blended with the asphalt, we found that the microfibrous material of this ash, or microfibrous material of this pyrolysis char, is said to be embedded into the matrix, so that it gives the reinforcing into the asphalt, so that it gives a mechanical strength, or otherwise it gives the dimensional stability to this asphalt mixer. And also, we could able to establish the strength and hardness of this asphalt composite matrix if we establish, and evidence through that same image and then edox, we can able to see that the chromium fixed into the matrix, it is in the non-leachable form. Of course, we did the leaching studies using TCLP and found that the chromium 3 plus was not converted to chromium 6 plus, and so that there was no evidence for extracting this chromium 3 plus or 6 plus from the bulks. And also we found that the softening point of the material was increased by increasing the residual soil into the asphalt. And also we said that the penetration of the material is reduced, or the hardness of the material is said to be high when you add this more of the the asphalt, that is the residual material, into that. Another important thing is this is also another area that's thrown onto this participant who can able to go further research on this and converting this very important solid material and into recovery or other useful material. Of course, I could able to say that it's a patented technology. I was very much successful on that to take it to the field level. And another one more thing, a bottleneck is also envisaged. That is the reason commercial level of production could not be taken up till now. So people can work on this, and of course we can able to get some novelty material, and so that will be helping the industry. This is nothing but similar to this. Some of this textile industry also got the similar problem, and paper pulp industry also got the problem. Wherever the people come across hydrogen chloride as a usage of the material, this problem would be available. So even in the case of dye intermediate manufacturing industries, that is diacetization, wherever they are making, there also they found that this particular material is said to be produced, so that a technology developed by this way, we can able to solve many of the industries by this clutch. And just we can say that this slide shows that what are the inorganic TDS present in this. That is, sodium chloride is the major contributor of TDS. In the first few slides itself, I showed that. That is, they are using acids and alkalis. So because of the usage of acids and alkalis, and also the sodium chloride used as a raw material or preserving material in the initial process, so that sodium chloride is considered to be very high inorganic TDS present in the material, contributor of inorganic TDS. And of course, in addition to that, they are adding sodium sulfide, chromium, calcium hydroxide, zinc chloride, mercury chloride, magnesium salt. These are also present in inorganic TDS of waste. Other than that, the industry has got organic TDS. Many of the compounds which have not been treated or degraded during the biological treatment will be found in this, the residual. They are contributed as organic TDS. Synthetic tanning agents, sulfonated polyphenols, modified glutaraldehyde, acrylic acid condensate, anion surfactant, aliphatic sulfonate, aliphatic sulfates, non-ionic surfactants, aromatic ethoxylate, aliphatic ethoxylate, preservatives, benzoazole derivatives, halogenated alkenes, chlorinated fatty acids, so many wide ranging. And then because of that, if you find that the characteristics of wastewater, the pH will be about neutral range, turbidity 850, high turbidity, and total dissolved solids, it is about 16,000 milligram per liter. Total dissolved solids in the range of 16,000 milligram per liter, and total suspended solids are around 4,200 milligram per liter. Chemical oxygen demand, the level of 4,750 milligram per liter. Biochemical oxygen demand is 1,100. Total order 1,600. Chromium 180 milligram per liter. Sulfide 120 milligram per liter. Chloride is huge. And you can find here total dissolved solid is very high. And of course, chemical oxygen demand and biochemical oxygen demand ratio is not maintaining it. And the ratio, if we find that it is approximately about 0.3. So less than 0.3. Because of that, the treatability of the wastewater is very much limited. And what are the configuration or unit operation they use that? First, equalization, now to equalize the wastewater of pH equalization organic string, and go to the primary clarifier to remove the suspended solid. And anaerobic system, they use that in order to convert this anaerobic, that is the organic molecules, into viable organic molecule. And because this limitation of the process is only about 60 to 70% of COD removal efficiency, and to remove further 30 to 40% of COD, they have to go by this, the conventional aerobic biogel technology. And this is very, very uneconomical, or otherwise we can say that this inefficient technique, that is the process. And since this residual COD present is not matching this, the discharge standard, and also high concentration of TDS present in it, it's a mandatory to go by this reverse osmosis process. And after taking out the water from that is nearly expecting that 30 to 40% of water to be recovered, and the water recovered has to go for the tanning process, tanning industry itself. And the rest of this, the reject, or other which have not been recovered, called a reject, and the reject has to be managed by evaporation in the forced evaporation system using solar energy, or otherwise they have to go by this multiple effect evaporator. That is, after this, the RO process, the reject comes out, is evaporated, the solid residue reject comes out either from this conventional solar evaporation or otherwise multiple effective operator, the residue has to be disposed of. For the disposal of this residue, as of now, they are just putting it on the second landfill. And this second landfill also will not last for a longer time. And then the technology was very much required to manage this salt residue comes out of it. That's what the picture I come into. The residual organics in the treated tannery wastewater may be due to the following reason: high refractoriness of the organic compound, the molecular configuration of spent chemicals in the wastewater is different from its original source, may be caused during diffusion into the pores of the tanned wet bloom leather, and the many of the organic compounds are not treated in the biological treatment. That's what these are the compounds comes out. And some of the compounds present using the fouling characteristics of the untreated compounds, suspended solid, colloidal solids, metal oxides, organic compounds, and bacteria that are present in the secondary effluent causing the fouling of the membrane. And because of this fouling of the membrane, we can say that replacement of the material is very much required, or frequently they are changing this membrane. And another important thing is, since you say that these membranes are fouled, so that recovery of that is water also very much reduced. And says that water recovery is very much reduced, so that it enters go into this reject. So that management of this water on the reject side is also very much high. So that energy consumption or the economical consideration for this is very much high on the foulant material present in it. That is, for that reason, they have to perfect this biological treatment. That's what people who are attending this conference, they can also, that is, suppose, are innovative or otherwise focus their mind to go for this development of new technologies for the biological treatment of tannery wastewater. That is, should be very, very important. As of now, the technologies available for them are that will be very inexpensive, that is, inefficient. At the same time, they are not economically viable. So that if economically viable biological treatment of the tanning wastewater is very much required. This is not only at this area, even in the future condition also, this is very much warranted. And many other things are said to be causing this, the fouling of the membrane. That's what I'm discussing on this. And one important thing is the soluble microbial product. This is also another important area where you can see that fouling of the membrane. The soluble microbial pollutant, where in which I want to touch upon the technology, the biological technology, which depend on the microbes. That is, where in which the people are going for the high sludge volume index. So once you have an idea on production of biological mass, thereby this the COD of the wastewater to be reduced is not a good technology. Because once you go for this biological growth, the excessive biological growth, another way we enter in the production of soluble microbial product, that is products. Once you get a soluble microbial product, that is one, we can say that it is that it gives a fouling on the membrane. Another one more thing, if it is thrown out on the sludge, again, management of soluble microbial pollutant in the sludge is very, very difficult. Once you take out the sludge for going for this anaerobic digestion, or otherwise, even if you go for this composting or vermicomposting, and this material cannot be degraded by these microbes, it's very, very difficult. So instead of developing a technology which depends on this high yield coefficient of this microbe, you can work on where the microbes have got low yield coefficient. So that type of microbes, if you innovate, and those are microbes, if you put into this practice of degradation of biological bioeffluent, and it is possible to have a good technology. And that's what we come into the point, where in which how you can go for the recovery of sodium chloride. This slides will show that how I invented this technology. High salt levels in the form of TDS is considered as the most significant pollutant tannery effluent. Conventional treatment methods does not remove TDS, that is total dissolved solid, from effluent, and pollution control board has directed all tanneries to install zero liquid discharge system based on RO system. That's why I said that RO system was introduced. After the introduction of RO system only, we faced a lot of problems because the reject came into the problem and the reject was to be managed. There is this conventional biological treatment as a what, and then this conventional biological treatment upgraded, and after that, the biologically treated wastewater after secondary clarification, it enters into the RO system, and RO system takes up this good water and rest to throw out this RO reject. So this RO reject goes into this evaporator, and where this goes for this calendrial is available, and this could able to evaporate this the RO reject, and so that condensate will contain again The condensate will contain this organics. If you are not able to remove the organics in your secondary biological treatment, and now it will find a way in RO reject, and when the RO reject put onto this multiple effective operator, and now the condensate of multiple effective operator will have the same COD. So that's what is not, you cannot avoid the biological, that is organics, unless otherwise you get into the new technology in order to completely eliminate COD of the tannery effluent before it enters into our RO system. Or otherwise, it is mandatory to reduce our COD before entering RO system to less than 100 milligram per liter. If you could be able to get this, the feed of RO system at the COD of less than 100 milligram per liter, the problem can be minimized. Otherwise, the problem can is said to be recycled or recoiled within this the treatment process itself. So now, my point is, when you use that multiple effective operator, the condensate will get the condensed stream, which contains high COD and requires some treatment. And after this, the treat evaporated. Now the reject, or otherwise the residue, comes out the bottom of it. It requires for disposal. That's why I say that this is nothing but a shuttle unit. And after this is the conventional forced evaporation. This is multiple effective operator. Vapor compression evaporators are now introduced. And this is again shows that evaporator is being working out. And after that, the residue is said to be present from the evaporator. The salt separator generally is at 50% moisture content. And for every cubic meter of effluent from raw to wet blue process, about a 12 to 18 kilogram of salt. For every cubic meter of effluent from semi-process to wet blue process, salt generation is 5 to 8 kilogram. The salt shall be brownish gray in color, resembling mostly powdery silt, and is not crystallized. So this is nothing but the characteristics of the evaporator residue comes out of the multiple effective evaporator. It shows that the salt or residue comes out as brownish in color or gray in color. It is resembling mostly powdered silt. That is, as like powdered silt comes from the wet soil, and it's not crystallized solid, or it's not a crystal. And this solid has got this mixture of 40 to 50-60% of sodium chloride. It is not completely sodium chloride because it contains lot of impurities like sodium sulfate makes up 15 to 25%, and calcium carbonate 10 to 15%, and calcium chloride 5 to 10%, nitrates will be about 5 to 10%, and other mineral salts contributes, organics is 2 to 5%. So that is the reason this salt or the residue obtained after this, that is multiple effective operator, you cannot use it as a material again back into the industry. So this requires a disposal. The salt from Zettel unit to treating effluent from semi-finish to finish level with another mixer. In most RO units operational, the salt produced is stored in gunny bags and is kept in secured storage areas, protected from rain and leachate reaching groundwater. So this is what now the people say, that the evaporator residue developed out of the multiple effective evaporator, they store in the bags and they have to put it under shade. So they cannot throw it on the secured landfill. Secured landfill will not admit this salt because it contains organic matter. So because it contains organic matter, they are not taking it to the secured landfill also. And option they are doing now, option of segregation of salts, particularly in between sodium chloride and sodium sulfate, is studied. Chemical and physical segregation required. And of course, they contacted me when I was in CLRA, and we could able to develop a technology that is taking out sodium chloride or crystallization of sodium chloride. I did. So crystal sodium chloride I could able to recover. That was my product. And similarly, that company tried or resourced other the technologies. That is a technology like fractional crystallization done by GA Maso, Germany. And separation of salts by differential solubility method studied by Swens Technology, USA. And separation of salts from by differential speed centrifugation, Bertram, Switzerland. Many people have tried, many technologies have been tried. Out of the technology which I developed was considered to be very good technology. It is cost effective technology. And objective was to, that is that's what it says, that how we are going for this. How objective was to separate our pure salt from mixed salt, other salts to be converted into sodium chloride using HCl gas. That is what our raw material. That is, I'm using HCl. This is very, very simple concept. That is, if you go into the physical chemistry, you say that the sodium chloride can be separated out by common ion effect, because chloride is said to be present in your salt, and if I use chloride in the form of gas, and then this sodium chloride can be separated out. That is called common ion effect. And using that basic principle, I could able to precipitate out sodium chloride by purging hydrogen chloride gas. The solid residue left after evaporation and multiple effect evaporator was treated in to recover sodium chloride. And after the elimination, because after the elimination of sodium chloride, and then after separating the sodium chloride, now the wastewater will be left out with the sulfate. Now, my idea was to separate out sulfate. So, in order to separate out sulfate, I just used either calcium, that is a lime, or magnesium, so that the sulfate was precipitated as calcium sulfate. After the separation of calcium sulfate, I will be left out with only the impurities. For the removal of the impurity from the residue liquor, I tried some catalytic oxidations, and the catalytic oxidation could eliminate the organics also, so that the salt residue which was containing sodium chloride, sodium sulfate, and calcium carbonate and other things. And just by purging this HCl gas, first I can eliminate carbonate and bicarbonate carbonate as carbon dioxide. Then we have got sodium chloride and sodium sulfate and other calcium compounds. Sodium chloride was recovered as sodium, that is using HCl gas, sodium chloride was eliminated. And second thing, sodium sulfate was converted to calcium sulfate along with other calcium ions present in it. So that now the water will be free from chloride, sulfate and sulfate. Now we have got only that organics. That organics were treated by heterocatalytic process, so that the process was completely giving a good result. So this is what I say that. So we can say that the precipitating agent, the sodium, that is the residue, is prepared as a saturated solution and charged into the reactor. And HCl gas required is generated and purged into this reactor. And this is the first stage, second stage, third stage. And the salt obtained was purified or otherwise washed thoroughly. And the residual salt is, that is required salt, is free from all contaminant and used for reuse purpose. And the water, that is water, after treated the water, it is sent to the heterocatalytic treatment where the organics were eliminated. So first stage is recovery of the sodium chloride, second stage recovery of sodium, that is calcium sulfate, that is sulfate as calcium sulfate, and third stage is elimination of organics present in it. So that's what you can say that. The saturated solution of this residue will be like this, and passing through this, the precipitator, once the precipitate sodium chloride will be settled at the bottom, and then we can say the residue liquor now will contain sodium, that is sulfate. Mm-hmm. This sulfate is will be precipitated as calcium sulfate. After the elimination of sulfate, now the water will be treated through heterocatalytic oxidation, and final liquor will be like this. So this liquor can be meant for disposal onto the site. So this water is recovered, that is, can be reused further in the industry, or otherwise it can be disposed of easily. And of course, initial tests by CLR using lab scale unit confirmed that the process conversion of other salts into sodium chloride and precipitation of some other constituents is possible. And bench scale trials were tested, and pilot scale level also we tested and wanted to take further into the field level. And there's some that is a bottleneck I find, that's what I illustrated later. And this also tested at the semi-pilot scale, we could able to pass this hydrogen chloride gas into the precipitators. And after the sodium chloride was precipitated, I took out this that is supernatant and precipitated as calcium sulfate for elimination of sulfate. And the water further on that treated heterocatalytically and disposed. So semi-pilot scale to the level of 100 kilogram per batch, I could be able to develop, and then it was successfully given the result. That's the salt from the residue will be like this. After treating that, after drying it further, the salt will be like this. So initial residue will be in this form. After recovery of this sodium chloride from it by this sequential precipitation, now we can get a pure edible salt we can get out of this. And some of this residual organics could be eliminated or otherwise heterogeneically catalytic oxidized. This mass balance shows that initial saturated solution has got the COD of 6000 milligram per liter, and after treatment we'll get only 44 milligram per liter. So that we could able to reduce this COD considerably by process like after the removal of sodium chloride, after the removal of organics, we can able to eliminate this. And TDS also, whatever the TDS present in it will be finally present as salt. And of course, the significance of the study, This was the first time ever we tried this precipitation of sodium chloride from the impure mixture, which contained equal quantity of sodium sulfate, was demonstrated. And if it is installed in the large scale, the project could address the most important questions of ultimate disposal of salt produced by the Zuttal system. The cost of pure salt produced was very high. It is nothing but equivalent to our Tata salt we can able to get there. And the technology can be replicated for purification other ways. And of course, at this stage, when it was patented and demonstrated, my confidence level was very little. Now, after this, again, some more innovation I made. And now our comfortability level in making this process very much successful. So people are chemical engineers who are interested to work on this, and still you can take up this issue or this problem further in the field, and we can able to get into this required level of the disposal. With this, I propose thanks to the people. I just go for the conclusions. Leather industry generates solid waste approximately by about 55 to 60%. Animal flushing, the protein solid waste can be considered as a substrate for the production of biomolecules such as enzymes, antimicrobial agents. I said another one more important biomolecule also I invented that has got a very high commercial value, and which can go for this decontamination of soil, and then you can go for this leachate management, and so many advantages are with this biomolecule. And chromium impregnated leather solid waste could be converted into nanofibrous carbon matrix, and nanofibrous carbon matrix can go in for making this construction material, as well as we can say that in the road making industry. And there is nanofibrous carbon matrix can be blended with potent cement and can be incorporated in making these construction blocks. The sodium chloride content of evaporated residue of RO reject stream can be successfully separated by precipitation technique for reuse applications. This could be my conclusions. And with this, I propose thanks to Dr. Puttasamy, and who has given me the opportunity to present this, the innovations, all these slides, what I showed, nothing but bench level experiments I made, and some of them are experimented on the field level, and all are patented technologies, what I presented so far. So I propose thanks to the audience also who patiently attended to this, and then take benefit out of it, and then we can work further on this. You can use my email ID, ganeshansekaran@gmail.com. And my mobile number is 9677010656. Any other people, any other staff member who are interested to work on this, I'm readily available, and we can have some more collaborative work and take forward to further level to benefit the industry. This slide also shows that the raw material, which is being converted to finished leather, while they are producing this finished leather, they are generating solid waste and liquid waste. And if they completely treat that water, and then we can say that completely eco-friendly landfill, that is land site, can be developed, and the land can be used for grazing yard for this animal's back, and this animal slaughtering can be possible. So that recycling is very much possible. So intervention is required here. So this is, as I told you earlier, the industry is doing here. So the industry is doing its job very well, converting this raw material into finished leather. But this conversion of the solid waste into the useful material, are providing a material to this environmentally benign material. It is not being done by environmental consultant or environmental technologists like me. So that we have to have a technologist. If we provide a technologist, of course, we can able to justify by this the environment, and also we can support the industry to go further on this. Isn't it? With this, I propose thank to the people once again, and the management who have supported me. Thank you very much. You can now for this discussion.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Shekaran, sir. I think it was a wonderful and lot of practical innovations you have shown, actually, and whatever your work. I request the participants to just, there is a one person, one participant, Professor Murli, T.G. Murli, is asking, formaldehyde is used to retaining of leather, yes, in carcinogenic material,
yes,
and affects people, and how to ensure zero liquid discharge and complies BAS norms or something like that. Please explain, he's asking.
Sir, actually, that is Murali, formaldehyde, that is, as you say, that the formaldehyde tanning, they were using it. But now they changed it. Recently, the leather industry, that is CLRI, I changed this formaldehyde based tanning into melamine based technology. That is a novel technology they have developed. It. The change of this available. And as I rightly put that, the farmer did is continuously using that. That is the difficulty in managing. One is the carcinogenic in the processing level. Even when it comes to this field also as an environment liquid effluent, it's very difficult to manage. And that's why the continuous research by the Central Lazarus Institute now came up with the idea that instead of formaldehyde, they can go by this method. That is possible. And another one more question they asked is ZLD, you know. What is that question related to ZLD?
That is ZLD system he is asking.
ZLD system is nothing but zero liquid discharge system. Because it has been practiced. It is practiced. That is primary treatment, followed by secondary biological treatment, tertiary treatment like sand filtration, carbon filtration, followed by this is the recovery membrane separation process. That membrane separation process is then recovered water go for the industry, and whatever the reject comes out, it go for this evaporation and the multiple effect evaporator and the residue. That's why I said that we have to manage that residue. That is the management of RO reject system or reject stream. It is said to be a big question mark. That is, we have to have some innovative technology, cost-effective technologies must be available in order to support the industry. That's why, right, because now the people are doing it with high cost. In order to treat 1 meter cube of wastewater in the tannery, it is taking about 200 to 300 rupees. So at this, that is 200 to 300 rupees per meter cube, it is huge money. With that, what is the, now the people are treating it. Suppose you are developing a technology which is even less than one third of it, then people will be benefited. Of course, they are doing this ZLD system. They have got zero liquid discharge and zero solid discharge. Both are available.
That is standard. Is any standard it will comply, sir?
Sir, that's what I say. That the standard means once you take the RO water, that is once it passes through the RO system, the RO water is recyclable water. So it is meeting the standard, no? That is possible. In the record, it is say that it is possible. They are doing it also. And then what is not possible is they feed to this RO system. That is not possible. They are not able to get it. But in order to manage or not to survive the industry, they are doing it. But as far as concerned, the feed of this RO system is said to be in the higher range. That's why they have to replace the membrane very frequently. And this is the reason they are going for this RO reject. Is concentration or volume wise also very high. So RO reject stream is very high, and so that the expenditure towards is also increasingly high.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Is there any other? There are some questions have been posted, but it is not clear. I'm unable to understand what they want to.
Even otherwise, they can post it to my email.
Maybe unmute and ask anything. Is there if somebody wants to ask any questions?
So the what I do, I have to stop sharing.
Sir, good morning, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. I am. Yes, clear.
Okay, so this is Neelavati Pari from Anna University.
Oh, yes.
Okay, so I am staying at Krompet, sir, from MIT campus.
Okay.
So you very well know that this Krompet, the name itself says that it was a tannery place a 2 decades before.
Yes, sir.
But still, the groundwater what we are having, from the latest recent test what has been made, still we are able to find the chromium and the salt dissolved in the drinking water, that is the underground water.
Yes.
So in spite of using RO, still we are having out some amount of chromium present in the water. So I hope this has got some health disorder. So what will be the solutions? What can we do for this, sir?
Actually, the treated water, that is your ground water, supposed to or otherwise subjected to have this chromium, and vegetable tanning also will be present in that. Some of the salt also present in that.
Yes,
but your RO system is properly well, then you should not get this chromium in your potable water, or otherwise the recovered water you should not have a chromium. So what we have to do is initially you put a filter, that is a carbon filter.
Okay.
Because now we can say that Iroka Fob, they are using this filter, no, carbon filters they are using it. That is sand filter and carbon filter, followed by that you go to RO. then you will not face the problem.
Okay, sir.
Because as such RO, now portable RO, that is you are saying that portable RO, and okay. Using that RO, just you are sending the water instead of having pressure, because it is nothing but you have got this only overhead pressure, using that it treating with this RO, and then RO water, it is nothing but working at a low pressure, so that chromium is said to be coming out in your water, that is recovered water. So instead of that, you can take or integrate with your Urecofoam's filters, no? They are having carbon filter, otherwise any conventional filters you can make. And passing through this sand filter, carbon filter, and then you send it to your portable RO, you will not have this problem.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. This possible.
Okay, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Hello, I am audible, sir.
Yes, sir. Very much clear.
I am audible.
Yes, sir. Audible. Audible. You can hear me.
Yes, sir. Myself, Dr. Anupama Rajput from MRIIRS, Faridabad.
Yes, sir.
My question is, which method is used to remove the unusual amount of salt which is present in RO system?
Yes, sir. So that's what I said, that is the one that is the last end of my slide, because many technologies that develop, and the technology for salt as a sodium chloride, no membrane system, because if the salt concentration is very low, we can go for ion exchange membrane or ion exchange resins. You can use ion exchange membranes are there, you can go with that. But when the salt concentration is very high, now ion exchange resins will not work. Ion exchange membranes are not working. So that's why the people go for this different technology like specific gradient separation and then crystallization technology. And those technologies are also not viable. Then in that concept only, I tried my technology to separate sodium chloride by hydrogen, that is hydrogen chloride gas impingement. And so that we could able to segregate or crystallize the salt. This was, I could able to get this. Isn't it? So right now, the sodium chloride containing water cannot be treated. Sodium sulfate can be treated, but sodium chloride cannot be treated. That is, when the concentration is very low, then we can try ion exchange resins.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Is there any questions, sir, dear participants?
Yes, sir. I am Pratima from BMS.
Pratima, you have to speak loudly.
Am I audible, sir, now?
Yeah, you are audible. You have to speak loudly.
Yeah, sure. Sir, actually, in one of the methods, you mentioned that the solid waste has been incinerated, whatever it is generated, and it has been stabilized with a nano iron. Actually, the nano iron, it is very sensitive when it exposed to the atmospheric conditions. So the long-term stability of nano iron keeping chromium in oxidation state 3, like how viable it is when we talk about the long-term stabilization?
Your question is over, no?
Yes, sir.
Actually, nano iron, why I was using it, this nano iron can integrate with the chromium to avoid the precipitation, avoid the oxidation of chromium 3 plus. As long as chromium 3 plus exists, the iron will not be leached out. So it is forming an integrated matrix or root way. So keeping this chromium iron also will be intact. And another one more thing, when chromium and iron is bonded together, it can form a ceramic bond with the ceramic material, that is silicate material, and calcium silicate materials are available in the Portland cement. So this can able to develop a ceramic bond. So both chromium and iron will be fixed up into the matrix, because you know that it forms calcium silicate as a gel. So the calcium silicate gel will able to integrate with this, the heavy metal ions. Okay. Are you able to catch the point? The chromium 3 plus is stabilized by this iron, nano iron. So in order to avoid the conversion or oxidation of chromium 3 plus, so that iron will be precursor for chromium, and both chromium and iron would be acting as a bonding with the ceramic bond. Through ceramic bond, it can able to help with the calcium silicate matrix, and it will be now fixed up in the Portland cement concrete mixture. And so that this will not be leached out. So nano iron, as you rightly pointed out, is carcinogenic, or otherwise it is said to be emitted to the atmosphere. So here, nano iron is not emitted, not allowed to emit it. That is allowed to be fixed up with this chromium. isn't it? So this will be cause, it is causing environmental hazard when it is converted or is thrown out in the atmosphere as a free ion or free metal ion. Isn't it? Another one more thing, once you fix up in the water, once you put it in the water, it is said to be bonding with water molecule. Because we know that ion can able to bond with six water molecules. So that is very stably fixed in this water medium. So it cannot cause, unless otherwise the ion is said to be leached into the groundwater, then it considers ion leach, that is contamination. But an ion no longer is said to be contaminated for this water or soil. No issue on that.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Very good. Thank you.
Hello. Hello.
Yes.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, audible very much.
Yeah, sir, my name is Dr. Sheena Gautam and I am from SRICT Ankleshwar, Gujarat. Sir, my question is from the anaerobic digestion. You mentioned in the beginning that the solid waste can be anaerobic digested and the products will be the carbon dioxide as well as the methane. But the byproducts are the volatile fatty acids and the sugars.
Yes.
So, have you ever tried to convert these volatile fatty acids and the sugars into the biopolymer, which is the polyhydroxyalkanoates? Because that is a very good source as well as a raw material for the these biopolymers. Because I am working in this field and I have tried with the molasses and other wastewater converting this biopolymer. So I have also studied in some European countries, there are some tanneries waste which they are converting it into the biopolymers. So I think that this can be one more value added products while we are working on the waste management.
Yes. Correct, ma'am. That is what your method is very correct. That is, that's also while I was touching that, I said that one, I can say that we can go for biodiesel. Biodiesel is not viable. Because many biodiesels failed. So instead of that, I thought that go for biopetrol. And another one more thing, intermediate acids produced by this. And you can able to convert into the polyols. As you said that rightly, good that the biopolymer. And as in the industry is concerned. So in this industry, even before that, before entering into volatile fatty acid, one step ahead of it, we can able to get amino acids. So condensation of amino acids into the biopolymers is also possible. So that route also you can look into that. That is, the intermediate acids, very good. You can say that carbohydrate, you can get the volatile fatty acids heavily. But in the case of tannery waste, we have got a lot of proteins. That proteins, we can say that intermediates will be amino acid. Don't allow to go for intermediate acid, long chain fatty acid. That is again third step. And instead of acidogenic bacteria, then we have to enter into this hydrolytic bacteria to convert into amino acid. We have to stop at this stage. And after getting the amino acids, then we have to enter into condensation with some condensing material and converting into polymeric material. Biopolymers can be possible at that stage. Even natural polymer also you can make it out of it. That is possible. You can able to go into the peptides. That's also possible. That's what innovation required at that level. That is, first we have to take one to two steps. Instead of go for this the acidogenesis and then methanogenesis. These two steps are not viable or otherwise economically good. And as you say that, you are doing with molasses. That is
The molasses and the wastewater, which is the industrial wastewater. And that wastewater is generally coming from different pharma industries as well as the different dyes industries. So that wastewater is basically getting treated. And after the secondary treatment, conventional secondary treatment, whatever sludge is there, so we're putting that sludge into the biopolymer.
That's what I said. Again, when you say that, again, you are making a mistake there. If you say that a bio sludge you are coming out, the bio sludge, again, you can say that you have to take the biopolymer in that because extracellular polymers are there. And you can able to take that entire bio sludge, convert it into bio.
That is what we are taking. So that is what we are taking.
Because as such, when you take the sludge, viable sludge or dead sludge, you will say that it will not be viable. So you have to take the extracellular polymer separate and also the protein content of it should be converted to the amino acid level, not to come to this volatile fatty acid level. That is, we should not extend furthermore. Before that, second stage itself, you have to stop and then you have to have some identified condensing method. That is, actually, you can have some hydroxy compounds. That hydroxy compounds can able to convert into condensation. And you can able to get already extracellular polymer is available. Along with this conversion also get this, a very good natural polymer can be get out of it. And still it will reduce your retention period, and then you can come out of this emission of ammonia, and you can come out of this hydrogen sulfate pollution, and so many things can be possible at this stage.
Yeah.
I think your route is very, very good. You can go on that. I tried in this line only, because I tried lesser than that. How could we able to get a bioethanol, how to get a biopetrol, how to get this biodiesel? My field study shows that don't go for the biodiesel. That's what I could able to conclude on that. But some more I got that, I have to go detail into this anaerobic system. And I want to prove that the anaerobic system is inefficient, how to increase that efficiency of this. Then now at present, what the conventional system or conventional anaerobic systems available should be upgraded. And what are the mechanisms present in it? How to overcome this bottlenecks? These are the interesting area I want to go.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay.
Sir, Shekhar, sir, I think you have answered most of the questions and you have taken almost 2 hours. Okay.
2 hours, sir?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So,
that's what I told you, that you should modulate it, because otherwise I keep on talking, no? That is again.
Sir, one request actually, we need to share this presentation material. If you could convert it to PDF or whatever confidential information you can remove, and then you can share it, sir.
I'll send it to you.
You can mail it to me. I'll share it with the participants.
Okay. I'll try to convert that.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you very much, sir, for your time, as well as considering our request and being part, in spite of your busy schedule and traveling and adjusting for our request, and coming back and presenting, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. I do it because really, I just participants.
Yeah.
Very few are asked. And then other participants also can integrate with us, interact with us through the mail and then mobile through you. And then some forum should be developed out of it, because they sat for about nearly 5 to 6 days. This should not be just for getting the certificate.
Yeah.
And this forum should be formed as a team, so that good research should be coming out of it. And then research proposal should be made out of this, and so that they have to go further on this line, and so that there will be benefit on this. So they should not be happy. They should not be contented with just getting the certificate alone.
Yes.
That is my humble request.
Yes, sir. When you are coming to Bangalore or Karnataka, in your next schedule, please make a plan to visit our college for 1 or 2 hours, sir. Because
I'm coming to Raichur also. This week I said Aligarh I'm going. And then when I'm coming, either one of these, definitely I'll give a schedule for you. I'll meet certainly with your research.
So you are visiting Shilpa Medicare, sir?
Yes, sir. This month, within this 1 or 2 weeks, I'll go there.
Yeah.
And another one more thing, this Aligarh also I'm making this week itself.
Yes, sir.
And either one of these, I'll give it a call, sir. So definitely we'll meet.
Yeah, I know Sharath Reddy, I think he's...
Yes, sir. He was calling me. During this lecture, he was calling me.
Yeah.
And I'll go there on second week or third week.
Okay.
And because now the route is very much fixed up, I'm not taking this train route. I'm going by air route only.
Okay.
And probably I'm touching the Bangalore or Hyderabad. So when I touch this Bangalore, definitely I'll give a waiver.
No problem, sir. I request you to plan for 2 hours with us in college.
Oh, sure. Thank you.
Okay. Next visit, sir.
Sure. We have to have a lot more things, because even otherwise, if possible, we can meet on Zoom meeting also.
Yes, sir.
We can have a discussion.
No. Since you are coming, I want to make use that personal meeting, sir, because I will call all my faculty and then we will have a one discussion and on various aspect of research and what we can do, all those things.
Oh, sure.
That is the reason I want you to first visit should be a physical and then maybe virtual.
Sure, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your time.
Thank you.